Welcome, folks. I'm Sam Lesante. I'll be the moderator today on Modern Medicine. Of course, the main host of the show is Dr. David Moylan, who is the medical director of Simon Kramer Cancer Institute. We thought we would do a couple different approaches for modern medicine and try to give you additional information so you're fully aware of what's happening. Today, we're going to be discussing medical marijuana. I find that quite interesting, Doctor. I mean, the 23 states in the United States have already legalized marijuana for medicinal purposes, okay? So what would be the theme of today's show?
Well, first of all, I'd like to get out a definition of what medical marijuana is, because it's an exact term, and then look at the history, the medical history of medicinal plants and how they've been used in modern medicine through the centuries, and then look at what has been studied for this medication. And I also want to emphasize a couple false leads that we've had in medicine on various drugs that have been developed in the 20th century, and what lessons we might be able to learn from those.
Now, when the show is done, modern medicine is done, what would you want our audience to get from the show today?
I'd say the main take home is that marijuana is no different than many other medicinal plants, and it should be subjected to rigorous scientific study and not just pushed along because there's a trend or a popular movement throughout the country. Mm-hmm. You might know, Sam, that legislation has been introduced in the Pennsylvania Assembly looking at this very topic, and it'll probably be debated on and voted on in the next several months. So again, a educated electorate, very important. Mm-hmm.
So let's start with the fact that we're going to define...
Well, yeah, let's look at a definition of what is medical marijuana. As they say, it's an indirect, imprecise term. But the marijuana plant is cannabis sativa, and it has many, up to 60 to 80 active compounds in the herb. And several of these that seem to have medicinal worth have been extracted. Among those would be THC or tetrahydrocannabinol, and also cannabidiol, which is another psychoactive compound. And as we see here, 23 states have come forward. Now, there's several other states that have pushed it as a recreational drug. We're not talking about that today. I want to make that very clear.
This is strictly
the medical aspects of it. And as I said, and again, that next slide just shows the herb, the weed as the leaf, and then capsules there, which could contain the active ingredients of any drug.
So when someone's on medical marijuana, are they taking the pills or are they smoking the marijuana?
Well, in the state of Pennsylvania, we do have access to some compounds. One is Marinol. It's a capsule. It's been approved by the FDA for some 20 years. And in fact, after 17 years, a drug will go off patent. So Marinol is now available as a generic, so it's even cheaper for patients to purchase. But our next slide is, again, looking at the history of it. That was part of my campaign for Congress. Let's look at the history. And the history on medical marijuana goes all the way back to 1550 B.C. Sam, you'll notice I'm using the term B.C., not B.C.E. This is before Jesus Christ,
right?
Not before the Common Era. Yeah. And cannabis sativa was mentioned in the Ebers Papyrus back in ancient Egypt, and that was used as a topical, more or less a poultice that would be put on an inflammatory condition. So it's been used medically for centuries, millennia. And the next is a list of medicinal plants, and I'd like to go through these and show the actual plants. But the first that's listed here is the coca plant, and that gives us cocaine. Now, of course, that is a drug of abuse in the United States, but it's also a very useful medical preparation, particularly to get anesthesia when we're doing procedures like a bronchoscopy, et cetera. But again, all of these medications that we're going to go through now can be associated with significant side effects. And with cocaine, cardiac arrhythmias, and I'm going to put my coroner's hat on now. We also will see deaths due to cardiac arrhythmias from these drugs such as cocaine. And I think the next, if we could show the slide of the coca plant, I think that's next. And the next slide is cannabis sativa. And I mentioned what's available there. The medication is Marinol, and that again has been approved in the United States for use to stimulate the appetite in AIDS patients and also in cancer patients. The other one that's listed there is Sativex, which is not currently available in the United States, but it's available in Europe. And that has been useful in conditions, neurologic conditions, such as multiple sclerosis, where muscle spasms are common, and Sativex will relieve such symptoms. But I want to emphasize that the difference between the plants and the pharmaceutical drugs is that we can measure them. We know how much activity is in Sativex, and that is actually administered as a transmucosal spray. It's a little squirt bottle, and so many puffs or squirts could be directed at the oral mucous membranes and absorbed that way. Mm-hmm. And but again, it's metered, similar to a asthmatic who has one of these rescue inhalers. There are metered dose inhalers, MDIs, and a precise amount of drug is administered with each puff. And that is something that is absent with the raw plant leaf or whatever. I think the next one that we're going to talk about is periwinkle. I think we have a picture of that periwinkle. What use is periwinkle? Well, that was, it's a vinca rosa is the plant, and they've been able to extract from the periwinkle plant a chemotherapy drug called vinblastine, and that revolutionized the treatment of testicular cancer in young men. And we'll come back to testicular cancer. But that revolutionized, and of course, everybody knows the story of Lance Armstrong, who had widely disseminated stage 4 testicular cancer, and he was cured, and that was one of the drugs that was used to effect the cure. So should we go on at this point? Foxglove is the next one. This goes back to the 1700s. It was a plant that was discovered in England, or was grown in England, and Dr. Withering extracted the active ingredient from that, and it was digitalis. And even since I started medicine 40 years ago, digitalis was at one time prescribed as a leaf, and it would be rolled up into a pill. But again, that's an example of an impure compound that was once used to treat dropsy or congestive heart failure. Now it's been purified, and we know exactly how many milligrams, nanograms of the active digoxin that is administered to control heart failure. But again, you can just see how crude it would be if we were still giving out digitalis leaf versus these precise monitored medications.
Now, all of these plants are being used in a prescription form. In other words, these are things that have to be prescribed, yep, before you can use them, correct?
Exactly. Okay. But that's where they came from, is plants.
Right. Folks, I'm talking to Dr. David Moylan. You are watching Modern Medicine. I'm moderating the show today. We figured it would give a good opportunity of learning about modern medicine. And you, of course, you know you can watch Modern Medicine on Comcast 190 in the Pottsville area, and up here in Hazleton on the Greater Hazleton area, which is Channel 13. You can contact Dr. Moylan at his Simon Kramer Cancer Institute. It's 570-277-6218. We'll be back right after these messages. Welcome back to Modern Medicine, folks. I'm Sam Lesante, and I'm moderating the show along with Dr. David Moylan, who is your host of Modern Medicine. And today we're giving you an in-depth look at medical marijuana, the medical process of medical marijuana. If you want to contact Dr. Moylan, he is also the Schuylkill County Coroner. He is the medical director at Simon Kramer Cancer Institute at 277-6218. So, Doctor, we could continue on with the plants that are currently being used for prescribed medicine.
Yeah, we just touched upon the derivative of digitalis, very important for the management of congestive heart failure even to this day. But the next one is... the plant actually was called the Jesuit bark, and there it's depicted here. And that was the plant, the tree, that gave us quinine, which, again, has for centuries been used to treat malaria. And I saw an interesting piece on the internet for President's Day, and it pointed out that Washington and Monroe, our presidents in the early part of our nation's growth, both of those suffered from malaria and were likely treated with Jesuit's bark. And the next plant would be the Pacific yew tree. And this story is quite fascinating. Goes back about 30 years when this yew tree in the northwest part of our nation provided a drug called Taxol. And we actually had to harvest it from the actual tree. Then they found a way of developing it from the needle so you wouldn't have to kill the tree. And then finally, they were able to synthesize it in the laboratory. But Taxol is one of the most potent anti-cancer drugs that we have.
Wow.
And it's used for treating breast cancer, lung cancer, head and neck cancer. It's wonderful to have access to that. The next one is opium, or there's the poppy flower. And of course, very important for providing us with codeine, morphine, and actually opium, tincture of opium was used to control diarrhea for years, but essential for managing cancer patients who have had disease recurrence and need pain control. But again, two-edged sword. A drug of abuse, and we're having tremendous problems with heroin, which apparently has become very affordable and is a plague. I think we'll probably talk about that in another session. But the last one I want to talk about is the last medicinal plant is the willow tree bark. And there's the willow tree. And that supplied us with aspirin.
That's interesting.
And to tell you the truth, aspirin would probably be a difficult drug to have passed by the FDA now because of we know it causes bleeding problems or whatever, but it's very useful and in modern medicine.
Wow, it's amazing. Now we move on to a slide. I find this interesting.
To remind us of some of the false starts that we've had.
The Boulevard of Broken Medical Dreams. And there you have... who's on the picture here? On the left.
This was a painting by Helwine, and it depicts James Dean, Humphrey Bogart, Elvis Presley, and Marilyn Monroe.
And why would you call it the Boulevard of Broken Medical Dreams?
Yeah, medical dreams, because we've seen these panaceas, these wonderful opportunities that are going to help mankind, and I believe that's the way the marijuana leaf is being sold to our constituents and electorate. And to show how we've gone down these paths before, I want to talk about Linus Pauling. And this is a list of his accomplishments. He was a famous scientist from one of the universities out in California. And in 1954, he was awarded the Nobel Prize in Chemistry. And again, in 1962, for his work in opposition to weapons of mass destruction, read that as nuclear weapons. He was also awarded the 1962 Nobel Prize. But he drifted a little bit far from his area of expertise and got into medical problems. And he was an enthusiastic advocate for the use of high-dose vitamin C as a cure for cancer. And you know, when people come in and they are given that terrible diagnosis, they're looking for anything that that might help them.
Absolutely.
And this, again, he has all this credibility, and he did some research in the 1980s and 90s. And it looked like it was going to be the answer to our prayers.
Does it help?
And, well, the Mayo Clinic, again, one of the premier medical institutions in the United States, if not the world, they said, well, let's test it. And they subjected it to a rigorous evaluation. And that is usually a blinded, where the patient and the doctor don't know what chemical is being infused into the patient's body. And then they analyze the results, see how long the patients lived, what was the quality of life, et cetera. And these were very high doses. These aren't the doses that you can take from your pharmacy, a gram a day or so, 500 milligrams. These were up to 10 grams of vitamin C. And the Mayo Clinic concluded that it had no beneficial effect whatsoever. So it was a false lead here. And also vitamin C, you think, how can that hurt you?
Yeah.
It can cause kidney stones because it acidifies the urine.
You're talking high doses.
In the high doses. And you trade cancer for painful kidney stones. It can also cause the blood to dissolve. It's called a hemolytic anemia. So again, these things are not innocuous. And I believe the same thing will apply to the leaf form of marijuana. Our next illustration is the thalidomide story. And of course, this was a horror that occurred back in the 50s. And it wasn't released in the United States, thalidomide, but it was used in Germany and some other European countries. And it was being touted to be effective for morning sickness in women and as a sleep aid. And actually, some samples were brought to the United States and were given to American women and some of these severe birth defects. It's called phycomelia. Instead of being born with arms and legs, they're born with little flippers. And again, this was a horrible thing. The FDA was strengthened as a result of that. And again, we have very strict guidelines for releasing drugs into the United States.
What you're saying is they put a big push on for thalidomide, and you know, in essence, it did not work the way it should.
Turned out it wasn't safe.
Okay. Are you using this example as a parallel with the medical marijuana?
Yeah, these two stories we just heard, vitamin C, not effective. Mm-hmm. Thalidomide, dangerous.
Right.
Side effects. So I'm pleading. That would be my plea to have medical marijuana either in its leaf form or in the various commercially available preparations, one or two in this country and in foreign countries, have that tested scientifically here before we prematurely embrace this as a panacea.
So the slide put up now, Sammy, is the commercially available cannabinoids.
I mentioned Marinol. That's number one. That's I can write a prescription for that in my office, and a person can go down to the pharmacy and fill
safe?
That.
Is it safe?
It's safe. It does have side effects, but we know about them, and it's not right for every cancer patient. But in this country, it's been approved as an appetite stimulant. The next medication is Sativix. Over in Europe, it's that's the trade name for nabiximol, and that is the one that is used for multiple sclerosis.
So your point of discussion here, mentioning these to the public, is what reason?
Marijuana, its active ingredients are already being tested both in this country and abroad. And my plea would be to wait for the results of these studies. We already have the mechanism in place to vet this preparation. It's called the FDA. It's been around since 1916. Sometimes it works slowly, but there also are pathways for accelerating the development of drugs, and perhaps that would be what the legislation needs to do, is to encourage acceleration of the studies, but not to bypass the studies.
All right, when we come back, folks, we're going to learn a little bit more about leaf marijuana versus man-made cannabinoids, and with your host, a modern medicine, Dr. David Moylan, who is the executive director for the Simon Kramer Cancer Institute, 570-277-6218. We'll be back right after this. Welcome back to Modern Medicine, folks. I'm Sam Lesante. I'm your moderator. The main host of Modern Medicine is Dr. David Moylan. And remember, folks, you can watch all of the Modern Medicine shows on our website at sspTV.com. Every show that we've done is up there on the website. Very informative information. Today we're talking about the medical marijuana, and we were talking when we left about some of the commercially available cannabinoids, right?
Yes, and of course the one that's commonly available on a daily basis in the U.S. is Marinol. And I've personally prescribed this for 2 decades with good results. Now, it's not a cure-all, but there's a condition called the cachexia anorexia syndrome in cancer patients. And for some reason, the tumor puts out a substance that just shuts down the appetite. And one theory is that it's a way of starving the tumor. Unfortunately, you starve the host, too, so it's counterproductive. But marijuana has anecdotally been associated with, quote, the munchies. Mm-hmm. And they were able to take THC out of the leaf and come up with a well-controlled dosed capsule. And again, that comes as various strengths, and it's effective. Now, interestingly, in older patients that might not have used marijuana recreationally, they seem to get some dysphoria rather than euphoria, and some of them don't like that sensation. So again, you have to tailor it to the patient. The next one on the slide is the Sativex, which has been used for the control of spasticity, muscle spasms, and neurologic conditions such as multiple sclerosis, approved elsewhere, but again, available as a well-controlled dosing mechanism where squirts of the medication are put in the mucous membrane of the mouth, and you know what the patient's getting. The next one is a Canadian drug, Sesamet, and that has been used in Canada to control nausea and vomiting associated with various chemotherapies. Now, I've spoken to some of my colleagues in the chemotherapy field, and they really don't see that would add much in the United States, because we have a half dozen other FDA-approved drugs that well control chemotherapy-induced nausea. And the last one, and we're hearing a lot of pleas from proponents of the medical marijuana issue about epilepsy in children. And there is a condition called Dravet's syndrome, and it's rare, fortunately very rare, where your standard anticonvulsants such as Dilantin, phenobarbital, Keppra don't seem to be effective. And there is some information that would lead us to believe that the marijuana derivative Epilidex does have some activity here. And in the United States, the FDA has fast-tracked the study of that preparation to see if it can be proven. But right now, as we're talking, Sam, there's no well-controlled double-blind study that would say that it's worth anything. Again, there's interest. Earlier studies suggest some activity, but not proved at this time.
Okay, we got about 2 minutes left. I want to talk about this leaf marijuana versus man-made cannabinoids.
Well, some of the problems with it I just alluded to, you cannot meter it. You can't determine how much of the active ingredient is getting into the patient. So THC is one of the very active ingredients, but probably some of these other 60 chemicals also have some role to play. And finally, as far as regulations go, there's a schedule system by the FDA, and marijuana is now listed as Schedule 1 again, so that does impede what can be done with it, just the way heroin is. However, if that could be
To cut to the chase here, yep. Is leaf marijuana, is that a good thing for people to be using recreationally?
That's a whole nother story. Ask me medically, I'm going to say no.
Yes.
We need to look at that through the lens of the FDA.
People think that this getting high, you know, is a good thing for them, you know, that, you know, it's like, et cetera. But what is it doing to their body?
Sam, there's been linkage of the use of recreational marijuana to head and neck malignancies. And also in young men, there's probably a twofold increase in the risk of testicular cancer, as I alluded to before. So we're taking young men that might have a seizure disorder below the age of 18, expose them to this, and then 10 years from now, 20 years from now, we're treating them for testicular cancer. So again, the caution signs go up like in thalidomide.
Now, the one way, on the last slide, there's no way to know if medical marijuana is pure. It can be contaminated by pesticides, mold, and fungus. This is the interesting thing. They're all interesting, but people are smoking stuff. They have no idea what they're smoking.
There's no quality control. Yeah. Let's leave it with the pharmaceutical firms.
Modern medicine folks, once again, the show is brought on to inform you, educate you. Dr. David Moylan is also the coroner for Schuylkill County, a lot of experience. He also is the medical director for Simon Kramer Cancer Institute. And you could probably write a book, Dave, of what you've seen at your cancer Kramer Israel. But you've also had some fabulous successes on your diagnosis and what you do at Simon Kramer Cancer Institute. And that's there's always hope, you know, and that's an interesting thing.
Springs eternal, Sam.
Yeah, that's right. Okay, folks, remember, you go to his website, simonkramer.com, to learn more. But if you want to see any of our modern medicine shows, sspTV.com. Once again, thank you for joining us on Comcast 190 in the greater Pottsville area, and, of course, sspTV, Service Electric Cablevision, Channel 13 in the greater Hazleton area. We'll see you next time on Modern Medicine.